Hello everyone and welcome to MedFF. In this video we will be discussing about the anatomy of the middle ear. So to understand the anatomy of the middle ear, you have to understand suppose the middle ear as a room. Okay, so if I make a room here, so this will be the superior wall of the room. Okay, this is one wall and that is like a curtain. Okay, that is made of curtain. There is no wall here. Okay, now this is one wall is hiding behind here. Okay, and here it is. So these are all walls of the middle ear. Okay, so here this curtain is referring to our tympanic membrane. Okay, let me orient you to this room, and suppose we are sitting inside the room. Okay, here we are. Now this curtain is literally, and this wall is medially. Okay, medially means this wall is more closer to the midline, and this wall is lateral. That means that this wall is more outwards to the midline, away from the midline. Okay, now if this is lateral wall and this is medial wall, this is lateral wall and this is medial wall, then this will be the anterior wall. Okay, and this which is hiding behind this wall will be the posterior wall. Okay, now this will be the roof and this will be the floor. Floor is which upon which we are standing. Okay, so this will be the floor. Okay, now this middle ear cavity is divided into three parts. The above part, this upper part is known as epitympanum. This middle part is mesotympanum and this lower part is hypotympanum. Okay, now starting with the lateral wall, so here we are saying that it is a tympanic membrane. Let me come out from this room and watch this lateral wall or the tympanic membrane while standing in the external auditory canal. Okay, so this is our external auditory canal. Okay, now we are standing here. Okay, and watching this tympanic membrane. Okay, here. Okay, so this is what we will be looking at. This is our tympanic membrane. Okay, sorry. Now there are three main parts of the tympanic membrane. The first one is the pars flaccida. Here flaccid is the word. Flaccid means that it is loosely attached. Okay, that is why it is flaccid. Now what is the role of this pars flaccida? It is also called as Schrapnell's membrane. Okay, what is the clinical importance of this pars flaccida? It is actually responsible for the formation of retraction pocket. Okay, retraction pocket means, suppose I am making this pars flaccida, this is our tympanic membrane. Okay, and here it is, this part is pars flaccida. Now if I look from here, so it will look like something like this. Okay, this is external auditory canal. Now this pars flaccida is forming a pocket here. This pocket will further go medially. I hope you are understanding what here medially means. Medially means more towards the baseline. Okay, now one more thing that I would like to discuss here. This is our tympanic membrane. Okay, and this is pars flaccida. color. This is pars flaccida. Okay, now here is the formation of the retraction pocket. This is our retraction pocket. Now the pocket will go somewhere in a space. Okay, if I have taken the images, let me check. Okay, so here this is our pars flaccida. Okay, it will grow its retraction pockets towards this space. Towards this space, and this space is called as Prusik space. Okay, now what is the importance of this retraction pocket? This retraction pocket can contain, and most of the time it contains, because retraction pocket is the most common cause of what I am going to say next. Okay, so it mostly contains the epithelial cells from the external auditory canal. Okay, so after when this epithelial cells goes in the retraction pocket, and because of that there is a activation of the macrophages and the immune cells. Okay, and this macrophage will come to eat these epithelial cells. Okay, and these macrophages will then be converted into osteoclast. Why? Because this epithelial cells will start secreting keratin, and to degrade it, the macrophage will become osteoclast, and then this osteoclast will start degrading surrounding bone too. Okay, so now this formation of this retraction pocket and the formation of the osteoclast, this is called as cholesteatoma. Okay, now what will happen? This retraction pocket will start destroying the surrounding bone. Also, if you see posterior to this posterior wall, okay, this is our posterior wall. Now posterior to this posterior wall, there is mastoid. So this and here there is one opening that we will be talking about. This opening is called as adytus. Okay, so adytus is the communication between middle ear and the mastoid. Okay, suppose this is a room. These are two rooms. Okay. Okay. So, one second. These are two rooms. This is mastoid cavity. This is not empty. There is mastoid air cells. And this is our middle ear. Middle ear cavity, okay, and there is a gap here. Okay, this is called as adytus. Okay, so by this adytus, this cholesteatoma will go here in the mastoid cavity and will degrade the mastoid bone and the air cells. Okay, that can actually cause mastoiditis. That can be a complication. Now this cholesteatoma, this old formation, is called as CSOM, chronic superative otitis media, squamosal type. Okay, so this is squamosal type of CSOM. Okay, now coming back to our pars flaccida, this was the importance of the pars flaccida, clinical importance. Now coming to the pars tensa, here tensa means the tension. Okay, so it is tensed means that it is pulled, and it actually provides the area of vibration. Okay, so because of this vibration of the pars tensa, these vibrations are further transferred to malleus, then incus, then stapes, okay, then oval window, and then inner ear. Okay, then it goes further to the brain. Now suppose if there is any perforation in the pars tensa, the vibrations will be lost. For your MCQ, you need to remember that the effective vibratory area of the pars tensa is 55 mm². Okay,